QuadJacks TV. Welcome back, Andy Frankenberger.
Hey, Marco.
Thanks for stopping by. All right, so this is, I guess, part two of a series we began yesterday called What Would You Do with Andy Frankenberger? You came to see us during a break.
Yep.
In the event
1500 6 max, which 1500 6 I max. Just busted, by
which
the way.
You just busted.
Okay. So keep that in mind. My mindset set is not the best it's ever been. My ace-king lost to Matisau's nines, and now he's making a nice little run, by the way. That's a little background to the live, where we're at right now. But getting back to that moment.
Let's jump back to yesterday, okay? You piqued our interest with a hand.
Right,
absolutely. You started telling us about
it. It was an interesting hand.
Could you please give us a quick recap and then, you know.
Yeah, the recap is we had a fairly tight, aggressive player in the four seat who raised pre-flop. I had kings in the small blind. I started the hand with 8,100. I 3-bet his 350. I made it 750. He called, we saw a flop, which was queen 6-6. I c-bet, which I would do on most flops there. I made it 1,000, he came over the top 2650. And I called.
You called, you decided
right.
to call.
And then the turn came a queen. And that's where we left off, and I said, what would you guys do?
Because it was your turn to act, your first
act. My turn to act, my first act.
You told us this was a pretty tag player, pretty fine aggressive,
yeah.
pretty
that's,
nitty.
That's how I would describe him, yeah.
Okay. All right, so
we're not super nit, but aggressive when he plays pots.
You decided just flat on the flop.
Yeah.
Right? What was your goal, by the way?
Bet call. I bet and then I flatted. My goal was just to see another card. I was very confident I had the best hand right there. And I was going to lead out again and let him make a mistake.
So if it had been, you know, a less scary card, you would have just bet out. That was your plan. Just bet out. And
if it was a less scary card.
Less scary.
On the turn,
yeah.
My point, at this point, my kings really aren't beating much in his range. I decided that it was very, very likely he could have ace-queen or even aces. For him to flat there in that spot pre-flop, I have to consider that there's a decent chance he's got aces. So I check, and...
So here we are. We're back.
Yeah, here we are.
So you actually checked. You
I
asked
checked.
Other people
yeah.
what they would have done. Actually, we had some...
Sorry,
we
gave it away.
I'm sorry.
I lost the punch.
We had some comments right here.
Right,
you know,
right.
People watched the video. Somebody says, re-raise all in on the flop IMO.
Who says that?
Pot-a-tube. Pot-at-tube. Brand yours? Re-raise
like
all
guy.
In on the flop. Wait, but the flop action's over. So.
Yeah, he's saying I could have jammed the flop.
He's saying you should have jammed the flop. Why wouldn't you have done that?
It's certainly a reasonable strategy, but... I actually thought I could suck out some more money from the guy. And right. I didn't want him to go away.
And he did have you covered, by the way.
He had me covered,
yes. We didn't really specify.
So we both had a lot of chips.
Our friend Hussein, I'm going to try to make some sense of this because he's not a fan of punctuation, but on the table I see, says, I see myself checking the turn 100% of the time. But now that he's heard you talk about it and he has time to think, he's asking, would it make sense to make an amateur move here and donk a small defensive bet and then check the river?
Generally, I'm a big fan of the blocker bet, but in that spot, it just screams of weakness when I've just bet called.
Right.
You know, obviously, the guy's, he struck me as a fairly thinking player. So if I'm donk betting out, that just looks super weak. And I think, I don't like that line. I think he's going to jam over the top if I do that.
Okay. So we're excluding that option. We're excluding the blocker
bet. Yeah.
Re-raise all into the flop, we couldn't have done that. Somebody says, you really have to fold if you go with your original read that the guy is a tight player. Just simply muck it, you cannot...
Tight aggressive, though. He's not just he's just not a nit. You know, some nits just sit back and they don't make any moves, and then you're definitely... Then it's very, very clear.
Right.
In the case of the tight aggressive player, you know, he can make moves with a lesser hand, like even jacks, to try to make a move.
Now, there. At this point, what are you afraid of at this point? An ace queen, you said?
Well, the thing is, the most likely hand in his range, the most likely hand. Well, we have to get to what he did, and then
okay.
before we say what I'm afraid of.
All right. And let's. So you checked.
I checked
the turn. You thought about it.
I thought about it. Yeah.
What are you expecting once you're checking here?
I thought that if he had a hand like jacks or even aces, that he would check, or a queen, that he could you know, potentially check behind. And I thought I could potentially see a free card.
At this point, you have to think, you know, what does he think that you have?
I'm representing a very strong hand, and I think I think he makes a mistake here by just going all in. If my read is correct, and he had me beat, which I'm fairly certain he did, he had me beat with a hand like ace-queen, or even aces. But I'm representing a lot of strength when I bet call on the flop. So I just didn't think that he could make that move without a queen in his hand, or potentially aces. So either way, I don't like the line that he takes by jamming, because he could have got more value out of me by betting something smaller. Or even checking to look weak.
Why do you think a player like that would check, or excuse me, would jam?
Well, I think that I had it at the time. I had an image of being a calling station at the table. I called down some pretty big river bets with marginal hands that won. So I just think he was playing into my image of just being a station, and I showed a lot of strength. And I think he thought he could just get me to call. And believe me, I did think about it. It wasn't easy, but really the only hand I'm beating in a spot like that once he jams is like a bluff with jacks or tens, and which absolutely he could have had. By jamming there, he's saying, okay, I don't want to see another, you know, potentially, like, right, I don't have a hand, I'm going to put you to the maximum pressure. And so ultimately, on day one of a tournament like this, what I just decided was, you know, it's okay to not know, to not know what the other guy has and say, you know what, I'll pick a better spot. Because you're never going to know with certainty. My thinking was he had either ace-queen, aces, or a hand like jacks or tens. So there were some hands that I could beat, but in a table where I felt I had the edge in play post-flop, I just decided I'd pick a better spot and outplay the guys on a hand where I had a higher level of certainty.
So you let it go?
I let it go, check folded.
And you don't even know what the guy had?
Still don't know what he had.
So we're not going to know either.
I can tell you
what
this.
What the hell, Andy? Not, I was hoping
I can tell you, he's not in the tournament anymore. So.
Oh, he's not?
No, I mean, I don't think he cashed, but he was a tough player.
Would you mind pointing him out to me if you're ever around and you see him? Would you point him out? Because then we can sit him down.
Absolutely.
And we can do, you know, the alternative version.
Absolutely.
Okay?
Yeah.
Awesome. Listen, I think you made a good fold there.
You know, I ended up surviving and making a deep run. But
in the absence, you know, in the absence of sufficient information, you're saying it's okay, you know.
Yeah.
It's okay to let go.
It's really important not to let your ego get.
Maybe you have some clues here or there, but that's not enough for a conviction. Right?
Sure. Not in that spot. In that spot, there were just too many pieces that pointed toward him having the hand he was
representing. Final question. What would it have required? What do you think it would have required for you to go with maybe a little bit more of a read and, you know, and maybe call or maybe do something different on the turn, you know? Can you think of something like
that? It would require a very different card than the one that fell on the turn.
Okay.
There's just no way I'm putting my tournament in life on the line when ace-queen just makes perfect sense there. The way he bet called pre-flop, the way he raised me on the flop, it just made too much sense for me to go with the hand there.
Okay. Well, listen, Andy, even though we may never know what the guy had, I've enjoyed this. I've enjoyed this discussion.
Well, we'll see. You know, it's nice to throw it out there. Maybe you have other guys on and talk about key hands and see how viewers and listeners.
I like the cliffhangers. I really like it. You know, because you didn't say, you know, like, how did this end? That might have been a little too easy.
6-1.
You know. 6-1?
Sure. You put up. You coming?
I didn't get what
6-1, and I'm not quite sure what he's referring to.
Oh, his final table. Oh, yes. Yes, of course. Thanks for that, Zach. 6-1, I get it now. I'm not sure. I thought you were talking about, like, your chip lead or something. But, okay. I like that. We should do this more often. Next time that you have an interesting hand,
and,
you know.
Yeah, I think you want to get the guy, like, on the next level, and I know that's my fault because I was probably trolling about. But, yeah, get him when they're still fresh in their mind, as opposed to when they just bust a tournament and are really salty. How'd you do, Kathy? Still alive?
I finished 70th, and I made an extra $100.
Yeah, you did. I finished like 79th on like a bubble, so.
All right, Andy. Well, listen, I am going to let you go.
Right on.
Thanks so much for stopping by.
Good chatting with you.
And we'll see you again. Talk about more hands. Good
cool.
luck to you.
Thank you.
Andy Frankenberger with the conclusion of What Would You Do with Andy Frankenberger? We're going to get a jingle and everything.
Ask him if he would buy penny stocks.
Would you?